This Technicality episode is brought to you by Squarespace.
Hey guys, I'm here. Let's get technical. Check out what happens when I do this. I hate it when I accidentally use explosive coffee instead of good old regular coffee. Anyways, I got everything all cleaned up, I switched out the coffee, and now, once again, check out what happens when I do this. Okay, just wait a sec. Okay, keep waiting. You know what, maybe we can get a time lapse of this. Whoa, did you notice that? When the coffee evaporated, it didn't just uniformly evaporate, it left a ring. Why does that happen? Turns out this common everyday thing has incredibly complex mechanisms behind it, and I'm gonna break it down for you lickety-split. Let's go make some coffee.
There are a couple of things we need to understand before we can dive into this explanation, and seeing as we're dealing with coffee, a good place to start is, what is coffee, and how is it made? Well, making coffee is pretty easy. You grind up coffee beans, take the coffee grounds, and put them into this neat little coffee maker right here, and sit back as the hot water flows through the coffee grounds and into your cup. The part of the process we're most interested in is when the hot water flows through the coffee grounds, because in doing so, it picks up a bunch of oils and various molecules that make coffee, well, coffee. You know how water and oil separates? Well, that's true for most oils, but that's not always the case. The oil in coffee is actually water-soluble. Just like how, say, sugar, a solute, would dissolve in water, a solvent, to create sugar water, a solution, oil in coffee grounds, a solute, dissolves in hot water, a solvent, to create coffee, a solution. That's good bean water.
Thus, coffee is mainly a solution. I say mainly because there is a reasonable amount of debris in coffee, making it also a suspension, and there are in fact some oils that don't mix with the water, making it also an emulsion, but for the most part it's a solution. That means that when the coffee drop evaporates, the solvent and the solute are separated, the water evaporates, and the coffee makes that ring. So now we know a bit more about coffee, but what we haven't looked at yet is the drop itself. That segues me nicely into the second thing we need to talk about before the explanation, surface tension. To understand that, let's watch my new favorite rom-com, The Particle of My Heart, Icle.
The Particle of My Heart, Icle is filmed in front of a fake studio audience.
Once molecules come in contact with each other in a drop, they're attracted to each other and want to always be close to each other. This is called cohesion.
Hey.
Me?
Yeah, I'm talking to you.
Aww.
Let me run towards you.
Wait, who are all these other molecules?
Oh, they're also attracted to us.
Oh, yeah, of course, cohesion.
Molecules like to be around each other so much that molecules in the middle of the drop, as opposed to molecules at the edge of the drop, are happier and more fulfilled in their totally existent life. Because molecules in the middle of the drop are surrounded by more molecules than those on the perimeter. Thus, it would be logical for molecules to form a shape with the least amount of surface area possible, so molecules can touch as many other molecules as possible.
Sigh. I love being around you, babe, but I'm so lonely. I just don't feel fulfilled in life.
Oh, that's fully understandable, babe. You're on the perimeter, which means you're not surrounded by that many other molecules. You know what? Let's form a shape where you can be surrounded by the most molecules as possible.
Aw, you'd do that for me?
Aww.
Well, I mean, it's the laws of physics. I don't really have a choice. But yeah, I mean, I'd totally do that for you.
The shape the molecules form is a circle, or a sphere if we're dealing with three dimensions, and we are. And that's how surface tension dictates the droplet shape. The molecules then formed a sphere and lived happily ever after. But it isn't happily ever after, because if it was, water drops would be spherical, and we know they're not, they're shaped like water drops. That's because we have to account for the adhesive forces between the molecules and the surface it's on that spreads the sphere out nice and thin. That force, combined with cohesion and gravity, creates the water drop shape, officially known as the spherical cap we all know and love. But we'll save that for the sequel, The Particle of My Heart-Icle 2, Electric Boogaloo. It is at this point in the video where I'd like to take a second and talk about a cause very important to my heart. Club Penguin, and its premature— wait a second! Play that clip of the coffee evaporating again. Notice something? When the coffee evaporates, the puddle doesn't physically shrink. It's sort of like the perimeter is pinned to the table. This is because, well, the drop is pinned to the table. The drop attaches itself to the irregularities and scuffed up spots on the table, and its perimeter doesn't move or shrink during the evaporation. Okay, let's put that all together. There's something interesting about how the coffee drop is shaped. The slope near the edges of the coffee drop is greater than the slope near the middle. That means that the evaporation rate will be higher near the edge, since evaporation corresponds corresponds with surface area. But wait a sec. If that's true and more evaporation occurs on the edges of the droplet, why does the droplet look like it's decreasing fairly uniformly and not just on the edges, creating a figure that kind of looks like the ohm symbol or a rising sun or a frowny face? Well, once again, surface tension. This shape is unsustainable because it means more molecules would be around the perimeter of the droplet, which molecules don't like. So in order to be in an optimal formation, the water molecules rush out to the edge carrying coffee particles with them. Then, because evaporation occurs more around the edges, the water evaporates, leaving the coffee particles behind. More of the liquid moves to the edge because of surface tension, the process continues until all of the water is evaporated and all of the coffee particles have moved to the edge, creating the coffee ring. This is the coffee ring effect. This effect was first observed by Robert Diggin and his team in 1997, who accredited the coffee ring effect to a, quote, previously unexplored form of capillary flow. What's that? Remember at the end of the last episode when I showed y'all how a cork would always float at the edge of a glass? Well, that's because of capillary flow, or as it's usually called, capillary action. Boom! You knew capillary action already! Look how easy it is! It's almost like I planned it! I honestly didn't plan it, so it's kind of great it worked out like this. Capillary action is when the adhesive forces between a liquid and a solid overcome the cohesive forces, and sometimes even gravity, thus moving the liquid. In the case of the cup, the water molecules are so attracted to the surrounding glass, they stick to the glass, and the cork, which will always float at the highest point, shows this. By the way, that curved water is called a meniscus. Another popular example of capillary action is paper towels. Check this out. With me, I've got a Tupperware filled with water. Now, I know what you're thinking. Alex, what's that water doing in there? That's not how Tupperware works. And you're right, so luckily I have my handy dandy paper towel here, and we'll just clean this up, if you will. Whoa, check that out. The water is climbing up the paper towel. This is another example of capillary action. The adhesion between the water molecules and the paper towel is so strong it defies gravity. Quick side note, in the process of researching this video, I found out that Tupperware was invented by Earl Tupper in 1942. And that's just one of those facts that'll impact your life in no way whatsoever, but is somehow oddly satisfying. On top of figuring out that the coffee ring effect is just a new flavor of capillary action, Robert Diggin also outlined three rules a droplet has to meet in order for it to be separate subject to the coffee ring effect. First, the angle between the surface of the drop and the edge of the drop can't be zero. Second, the edge of the drop is pinned to the table. And third, the liquid evaporates. Pretty straightforward. On top of that, he also outlined what doesn't have any impact on the coffee ring effect. Stuff like gravity, surface tension gradients, and more. Later, in 2011, Peter Juncker and his team expanded on that research. He tried to figure out how to prevent the coffee stand effect, and it turns out the shape of the particles is key. Coffee particles are circular in shape, meaning they pack really densely at the edge of the drop. However, ellipsoid particles don't. Quote from this 2013 write-up on the phenomenon, ellipsoids form a loosely packed network layer on the drop surface. That network grows in a fairly disordered way towards the drop center as more ellipsoids are pushed to the edge. With time, the network becomes even more rigid and resistant to the outward-directed flow-induced forces. Thus, when evaporation finishes, ellipsoids can coat the entire area under the drop. So to counteract the coffee ring effect, just add some ellipsoid particles to your solution. Now that we know how to counteract the coffee ring effect, we might as well ask why we want to, because the coffee ring effect applies to things outside of just coffee. There are everyday uses for the coffee ring effect. You wouldn't want ink or paint to dry with a ring around it, so it must be combated in those substances, but there are also more profound uses. Researchers at the University of Chicago are looking into how the coffee ring effect can be used to stretch DNA. Scientists can use the strong flow produced by the evaporating droplet to stretch the DNA, allowing them to do stuff like document patterns and find anything that could be wrong with the DNA, among many other things. While it's pretty hard to stretch DNA, it's really easy to create a website with Squarespace. Squarespace is hands down the best place to make a website, and to prove it, I made a website for my award-winning Don't Look That Up movie, The Particle of My Harticle. Yes, this is an actual website you can go to by clicking the I or the link in the description, and not only is it a great way for me to get the word out about my movie, it's also a great way for me to demonstrate Squarespace's phenomenal features. The first thing I did was pick one of their beautiful templates. I picked Miller because it was under entertainment and media, but they have tons of different categories. Then I made my about page because people need to know the story of how this work of art was birthed. I included a review from Steven Spielberg, who said, "This movie is really, really good." Did he actually say that? Probably. At some point. Did he say that about this movie? Stop asking questions. Then I added the actual movie, The Particle of My Harticle, to Squarespace because you can add videos to your website, making it perfect for YouTubers or anyone who works with video. There's even more features I didn't get around to using, like a powerful e-commerce platform, analytics that help you grow in real time, and 24/7 award-winning customer support. So if you want to try all of that out and support Technicality, go to squarespace.com/technicality and start a free trial today. Absolutely no credit card required. When you fall in love with it, use code Technicality at checkout for 10% off. If you like this video, thank you. That means a
lot. You should totally check out my other food science videos like This Japanese Food Could Have Killed Me and The Truth About Zero Calorie Foods. Click the end cards on screen right now. The social media I'm going to plug in this episode is my Instagram. I've been posting a lot of stuff over there and I've done a couple of Q&As on my Instagram story in the past. So if you don't want to miss that, follow me there at AlexUnico. Click the end card right now. And thanks to all my patrons at patreon.com/technicality, especially these awesome people on screen right now. For the secret code this episode, the number is 4 and the word is I'm. Thanks for watching DFTBA and explore on.